Let me tell you of mine. He's my forever friend. My leave me never friend. From darkest night to rainbow's end, he's my forever friend. Even when I turn away, he cares for me. His love no one can shake. Even as I walk away, he's by my side. With every breath I take. And sometimes I forget. My halo fails to shine. Sometimes I'm not his friend, but he is always mine. He's my forever friend. My leave me never friend. Darkest night to rainbow's end, he's my forever friend. If you still don't know the one I'm talking of, I think it's time you knew. Long ago and far away, upon my friend died for you. So if you'd like to meet him and don't know what to do, ask my friend into your heart and he'll be your friend too. He's my forever friend. My leave me never friend. From darkest night to rainbow's end, he's my forever friend. He's my forever friend.
One, two. Good morning, everyone. We are just about to commence, and so I will kindly ask that you take your seats if possible, and I will ask the family just to join. One, two. Please, may I ask the congregation to stand?
Shine a little light, give sight to the ones who've lost their way. There's a place for people like you. I've heard up there the streets are made of gold. And when you get there, there's a hand. place up there for people like you. If you walk around with your heart on your sleeve, and if you're trying to be the change you want to see, if you lay down your life for love so someone could be saved, there's a place for people like you. I've heard up there the streets are made of gold, and when you get there, there's a hand to hold.
Please be seated.
Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
On this very cold and unfriendly day, I just want to bid you a very warm welcome into the house of the Lord as we come here to celebrate the life of Sister Margaret Greaves. On behalf of the Greaves family, the Hackney Seventh-day Adventist Church, and the Holloway Church, who so kindly accommodated us today, we just want to bid you a very friendly and a very warm welcome. We want to thank you for taking the time out to celebrate her life with us today. We're living in very uncertain times, and I just want to let you know that this church is following the COVID protocol at this moment, so if we can, please, as much as possible, please adhere to them. Sister Margaret Greaves was certainly a woman of faith. We talk about the soldiers of the cross, and there's no one more a soldier of the cross than this woman of faith. I've never ever heard her complain, even when she was at her most sick times. Even when she was losing her sight, she never complained. And her life can be epitomized by these three words: God is good. Amen. You were never ever in her presence without hearing her say, over and over again, God is good. Thank you, Jesus. Yvonne and the whole family, on behalf of the Hackney Seventh-day Adventist Church, we offer you our deepest condolences and let you know that in times like this, we stand in solidarity with you. We feel your pain. I want to encourage you today to know that someone much greater than us feels your pain above all, and that is Jesus, your Savior. He's touched with the feelings of your infirmities, and he loves you more than life itself. So as we go through this program, I just want you to know that God is with us, his presence is with us, and he has promised never to leave nor forsake us. For those of us who are taking part in the program will run and announce. God bless you, and God bless the life of Sister Margaret Greaves. Amen. Our opening hymn is How Sweet Are the Tidings.
Sweet are the tidings that greets the pilgrims there as he wanders in exile from home. Soon, soon will the Savior in glory appear, and soon will the kingdom come. He's coming, coming, coming soon, I know, coming back to this earth. Savior comes to reign. The mercy, all grace, where the pilgrim sleep shall be opened as wide as before, and the millions that sleep in the mighty deep shall live on this earth once more. He's coming, coming, coming soon, I know. Redemption will sing from the north, from the south, all the ransomed shall come and worship our heavenly King. Sing, He's coming, coming, coming soon, I know. Coming back to this earth again, and the weary Savior comes to reign. Hallelujah, amen, hallelujah again. Soon in faithful we all shall be there. Oh, be watchful, be hopeful, be joyful till then, and the crown of bright glory will wear. He's come. Coming back to this earth again, again, and the weary pilgrims will to glory call when the Savior comes to reign.
Good morning again. I'm going to do the opening prayer, so I would like if we could bow our heads while I pray. Our Father and our God, once again, we children humbly bow before you this morning to give you thanks and praise for yet another opportunity that you have allowed us to see this sinful world. As we've come this morning, Lord, to lay your daughter, Sister Margaret Elizabeth Greaves, to rest, we pray, dear God, that whatever is done be to your name's honor and glory. We pray, dear God, that your presence may be felt in this building. May you comfort those who need comforting. May you hold those who are weak, and may you strengthen those who need strengthen. Be with the entire family. Be with the friends and the well-wishers. Lord, as the songwriter said, you're coming again. And we know that for sure, that you we know, dear God, that you're coming again. We ask you that you may take full and utter control over this service. Father, we know that things usually happen when we least expect them. When we think everything is okay, they're not. But dear God, you are God and God alone. So may you touch each and every person in this building, that whatever needs to be done, that it may be done. But Lord, as we present Sister Margaret before you, asking you, dear God, to watch over her as we've come to lay her to rest, to do our final farewell until you come. May you, dear God, take full and utter control. Father, we believe that we will see our dear sister in the land made new, in that heavenly kingdom, if we remain faithful and true to you. So I pray, O God, that you will bless the family in a marked and special way, that we only have today to make it right with you. So, dear God, if we want to see our dear sister, our mother, friend, auntie, in that heavenly kingdom, help us, Lord, to make it right, so that when you burst those eastern skies, you may say, well done and welcome to each and every one of us, as we have been waiting. Lord, as my elder said, we are living in troublesome times. And now is the time when we should be ready and waiting, not planning to be ready, but to be ready. So, dear Lord, help us to do what is right, so that we all can be meet on that glass, on that sea of glass, in that city made for your children. We thank you again for your presence here. Lord, we love you and we adore you, and we just continue to give you thanks and praise. In Jesus' holy name with thanks. Amen. 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 May be seated.
Good morning, church. Good morning, friends and family. I'm just going to read from Ecclesiastes 12, 1 to 7. Remember now your Creator in the days of your youth, before the difficult days come and the years draw nigh, when you say, I have no pleasure in them, while the sun and the light, the moon and the stars are not darkened, and the clouds do not return after the rain. In the day when the keeper of the house trembles, and the strong men bow down, when the grinders cease because they are few, and those that look through the window grow dim, when doors are shut in the street and the sound of grinding is low, when one rises up at the sound of a bird, and all the daughters of music are brought low, also are afraid of height and of terror in the way, when the almond tree blossoms and the grasshopper is a burden and desires fail, for man goes to his eternal home and the mourners go about the street. Remember your Creator before the silver cord is loosed, or the golden bowl is broken, or the pitcher scatters at the fountain, or the wheels broken at the well, then the dust will return to the earth as it was, and the spirit will return to God who gave it. Amen. Amen.
Hello, family and friends. I'm just going to give a tribute for my Auntie Margaret. I've got some friends behind me for some backup. So I really appreciate you guys coming up here as well. I am super blessed, and actually, we are all super blessed to have had the gem we've had in Auntie Margaret, also known as Aunt Dee Dee, and affectionately known to my family as Super Gran. Now, we say Super Gran, for those of you who don't understand where that term comes from, there's a cartoon character out there with a lady. She's quite frail, but she's powerful, and that's how we saw Auntie Margaret. Even though today has an element of sadness, it also comes with gratitude as we celebrate the life of our precious auntie. The impact she's had will certainly remain forever in our lives, at least my own. When I visited her, I was always guaranteed a short sermon, and that short sermon covered four areas every single time. The first one was, "Denzel, you must trust God." That's how she said it in the Montserratian accent. You know how it goes, for those of you who know. She always said, "I must trust God." Secondly, she said, to give God thanks always, no matter what. Also, she always gave us words on how much she loves her family, how much she loves us, but ultimately how much she loved God. And the fourth thing she always did, and I don't know how she did this, but she'd always recite poems, long poems, and she would recite them word for word, and I always was fascinated by her memory. Some of these poems she wrote herself, some of them she recited, but I was always fascinated. Auntie Margaret was able to tell us the real stories of life back home. I say real as in not just the sugarcoating of the good times, but also the reality of the struggles and the not so good times endured. These stories gave me an indication of where her strength came from, her gratitude and love for the Father above. I would always remember her words and encouragement. What an auntie she'll remain as I hear her voice within. I know we say this all the time on occasions like this, and you know it's something which we repeat a lot, but I live in the hope that one day we will sit together, maybe fly together. Let's not limit heaven. I mean, I just hope that one day we were to sit down and share our stories of how we made it over. So I say for Auntie, I just pray that she will rest in sweet peace. An amazing auntie. And respectfully, a friend. Now, when it comes to these occasions, I'm not gonna sugarcoat this. I get emotional. I may cry. So what? So I'm gonna attempt to sing a song I use the word attempt without very carefully. So bear with us.
Greetings. I bring you tribute, the first tribute from Roy V. Graves, nephew living on the island of Montserrat. Caring, sharing, persevering, and God-fearing were real in the life of Aunt Margaret Dede Graves. But how do I encapsulate 94 years of living through all the vicissitudes of life, the ups and downs, the joys and sorrows, successes and failures, the uncertainties and doubts of life. For sure, Aunt Margaret had experienced them all. Yet through her spirit of caring and sharing, her persevering and God-fearing life, she has been more than conqueror through Jesus Christ, her Lord. Scripture and prayer were her constant companions, and a word of encouragement was ever on her lips. She loved the Word of God, believed and practiced the Word throughout her youth and adult life, in spite of failures along the way. Aunt Dede was our family's historian, answering any questions about our ancestry with amazingly minute details. Such was the quality and clarity of her memory, even in her 90s. Though the smallest among her 9 siblings, do not judge this book by her cover. For Aunt Margaret was a strong tower for sisters and brothers and church brethren when they were down, and a bulwark for her 3 children, Dudley, Yvonne, and Alvin. Aunt Dede trained and ceaselessly encouraged them, her children, to live in the fear and admonition of the Lord. Dudley, Yvonne, and Alvin, through Jesus and the boundless grace of God, your mother fought the good fight. She has finished her course. She has kept the faith. Henceforth, there's laid up for her a crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, shall give her in that day. This is our hope. So go and do you likewise. I thank God for the life and times of Aunt Margaret Greaves. Those words were penned by Roy Greaves.
Good morning. I'm reading a tribute on behalf of my father, Lorenzo Greaves, who couldn't be here at this time. Aunt Margaret, better known to us as Aunt Dee Dee, leaves behind a rich legacy that will keep the flames of the Greaves family heritage ablaze. Her unique personality made her stand tall, although she was very short in stature. Her genuine love and care echoed in her words of encouragement and many prayers which she offered for us. We will miss her pleasant voice in the background, telling Yvonne to tell La, keep trusting in God. Tell La, I am praying for him and Yulin and Amani. Tell La, I say hello. We thank God for the many prayers that she has offered for us. Aunt Dee Dee was a God-fearing woman and a praying aunt. The fond memories of my childhood visits to her home and the lasting bonds that were created, we will continue to cherish. These visits were made special by the baked goods of our dear cousin, Yvonne. Aunt Dee Dee's home was very welcoming, and we are thankful that she provided the environment for us to bond with our cousins, Yvonne, Dudley and Alvin. We share in your grief and celebrate the life of your mother, our beloved Aunt Margaret. Aunt Margaret will be remembered for her warm, bubbly temperament. I will forever treasure the warm embrace I received on Sunday, 7th November, 2021 from Aunt Dee Dee. That day will be forever etched in our memory. Aunt Dee Dee heard that I was ill and in the UK for medical treatment, and she got dressed very early that morning. She was very anxious to come and see me, and Yvonne, faithful to her promise, brought her to see us. One of the memorable moments of our reunion that morning occurred when we decided to take a picture with Aunt Dee Dee. She was excited to take the picture, but we had to wait for her to fix herself. Wait, let me fix myself. Let me look good. With an endearing chuckle is characteristic of Aunt Dee Dee. She took pride in ensuring that she was always well-dressed and neatly attired. Aunt Dee Dee was always beautifully adorned, both outwardly and inwardly. She had a quiet and meek spirit. Aunt Dee Dee was gifted with a remarkable memory. She was a talented orator. Her recital of the poem, "When I Take My Vacation in Heaven," brought life to the imagery which was framed in my mind's eye of heaven. When Aunt Dee Dee did her recital, she captivated your attention and made the desire to see heaven burn within your heart. Aunt Dee Dee also had an infectious laugh, and her ability to enjoy a sweet joke added to the warmth which made her special and dear to us. We thank God for the opportunity we have had to spend quality time with our aunt. We thank God for the positive influence she has had on our lives and the love that she exuded while she was alive. We take hope in our understanding of Scripture that she is now sleeping, awaiting the second coming of Jesus. She has made her mark on the tapestry of our lives. The baton has been passed. May those who come behind us find us faithful. May God bless and keep our family as we mourn the loss of our stalwart, Aunt Margaret Greaves.
I bring this tribute from Eloise Daly in the United States of America. It is with deep sadness that I pause to reflect on my experience with my loving cousin, fondly called Didi. Cousin Didi was very close to my mom and her family. I enjoyed the love displayed by both as I traveled from Glebe to Flemings, taking messages between each other. It was a joy despite the walking distance. Her smile, affection, and hospitality were so genuine. It became a treat going between both homes. Upon each visit, I was greeted with the warmest hug, a refreshing drink, and treat. She would let me play for a while with my cousins. Then she would walk with me to Mas Olin's home, give me a big hug, kiss, and wait there until she saw me almost in Salem's shopping center. Then she would shout, "Bye, Elo." She was very religious, and I look forward to seeing her and Mama hug and greet each other on Sabbaths and Wednesday night prayer meetings at the New Carmel Seventh-day Adventist Church. I can only imagine how many lives she has touched so fondly. Yes, there is a vacant chair, but we linger to caress her as we say our evening prayers. When I think of heaven, I yearn for that moment of seeing her and Mama embracing and hearing their sweet voices echoing through those gates. Sweet be your rest until we meet again. Another tribute from Kelvin Tabu Jubri, adopted son and friend living on Montserrat. Didi was my mother from a different village. I will never forget my youthful days in Salem as a youngster going to the Salem Junior Secondary School. I met Kitaka, a young Rasta man, and was drawn to his faith. This meant that I was in Fritz Village almost every day. I then met his cousins, Dudley, Algie, and Yvonne, to whom he was closely connected. From then, we developed a special bond. It was through them that I met their mother, Didi. From that time, she became my mother, and I became a direct member of the family. Many years after, and as a result of the volcanic crisis in Montserrat, I reconnected with Didi when I met her in Ridley Market. I never allowed her to go home alone. I made it my duty to accompany her, helping her with her shopping. She always showed me love and never let me leave the house without asking me if I wanted a drink or if I needed traveling money. I was very proud to call her. I was very proud to have her call me son. My heart feels very heavy as I realize I cannot be there in person to say goodbye to a lady and mother that I knew for more than 45 years. However, let me say I love Didi as if she was my biological mother. Rest in peace, Didi. Ja will be waiting there. This tribute is being sent with prayers.
A very good morning to one and all. A church and personal tribute for Sister Margaret Greaves. I first met Sister Greaves in the early 50s at the New Carmel Seventh-day Adventist Church. Her parents were one of the early pioneers of New Carmel under the leadership of Pastors Walker, Fortune, Giddens, and Goodens. New Carmel was the mother church on the island. There were a large number of young people at the church. During MV, we used to call it missionary volunteers in that time, it brought back memories in writing this tribute. I remember how quick Margaret was on Bible characters. There were two in mind. I'm thinking of a Bible character whose name begins, let's say, P. She was one of the first whose hand would rise to give the answer. When it came to finding the Bible text, Margaret was there to find it first. It was really fun in the church in those early years. She was an ardent Christian, being brought up in a Christian home. She was a lady of high caliber, an impeccable Christ-like life. I left Mansrat in 1955, did not see her again until 2001 at the market in Dalston. I was elated meeting her, so I said to her in Montserrat patois, jokingly, "You girl Didi Greaves, lovingly, how you do?" Which was her second name, Didi. She answered me back straight away, "You boy John Locker, no call me no Didi," laughing. "Call me Margaret a day a England me day." We all left smiling. At Hackney Seventh-day Adventist Church, where she attended, her membership was transferred from the New Carmel Church on the 19th of May 2001 to Hackney Seventh-day Adventist Church. The zeal and enthusiasm at Hackney was as active as it were in her early years in Mansrat. She has been present in church for a number of years. Until the last 3 years, she has been housebound with problems with her eyes. The deacon and deaconesses has visited her every month. The pastor and elders has given her communion once a quarter. She was a faithful tithe and offering payer in supporting the church. She was an ardent Seventh-day Adventist, kind and affectionate. She would be gratefully missed. Shakespeare quotes, "Heights of great men all remind us, we can live our life sublime, and departing leave behind us footprints on the sands of time. So, my dear sister, until then our hearts will go on singing, until then with joy we'll carry on, until our eyes behold the city, until the day God calls us home. So, our dear sister, mother, aunt, cousin, nieces, friends, you have fought the good fight. You have finished your course. May you rest in eternal peace."
Good morning, all.
Good morning.
thank you for coming, joining us as we pay our last respects. Life is precious. Yet, many take it lightly. Within the last 3 months, 3 members of our family passed in quick succession. And I foolishly asked myself, why? As if I didn't know better. On the 16th of December, Thursday evening, my niece called me from the Hamilton Hospital and said, "Uncle, come now." I had to call the ambulance because Mom is very sick. Without hesitation, I got there. And when I arrived, I met my niece in one small room on her own. And I asked, "Where's Mom?" She said, "She's in admission." I went into that section and she was there lying down. I asked her, "How are you feeling?" She said, "I'm feeling very sick." And we prayed right away because I only had 15 minutes to be in that area. I prayed with her quickly and then we had a short chat. And within that time, she said to me, "I hope that they discharge me quick enough that I can get to my brother's funeral because I didn't get a chance to talk to him before he passed." Now, as I said before, 3 members of my family passed within such short period of time. My sister-in-law, my brother, and my sister, even before my brother's funeral. On Friday morning, 17th of December, my niece called me again. I was getting ready because I told my sister, "Look, I will see you in the morning." That was Thursday evening. I told her, "I'll see you in the morning." So Friday morning, 17th of December, I was getting ready to go back to the hospital. My phone rang. It was my niece again calling me from Hamilton Hospital. And she said to me, "Uncle, come now. Mom is dead." My heart sank low, low, low. I got to the hospital, into the ward, and there I met my niece again sitting in the room on her own beside her mom, well, not her mom, sitting beside the remains of her mom. I just couldn't take it. However, let me say, my sister Margaret Elizabeth Greaves and her twin sister Agnes Florister Joseph are the first of our parents' children. I loved all my siblings, but for my twin sisters, I had special love and respect for them. Reason is, they treated the rest of us as our mother would. So I developed the idea of saying, I have two mothers. My biological mother and two disciplinarians. Yeah, I guess you heard a few things about my sister a while ago about, and it's all true. As a child going to school, my sisters, they would make sure hair is combed, nails are clean, teeth are clean after eating, the clothes are fixed properly, and you're on your way to school. Normally, we at school we play with marbles and cricket ball, etc. And my brother and myself, we normally fight for marbles and all ball and things like that. Some, if I have six marbles in my pocket and my brother may have four, you know, we have to have equal amount. So, but if I have more than him, he would feel a bit jealous, then I say, I shouldn't have more, and then we start fighting for it. And then now, all we have to do, whoever is wrong, or, you know, they'll hear from my sisters. So I may go and complain to my sisters, not my parents, my sisters. And they will put us straight. You know, that's what they'll do. And you know, over the years, you know, I get to respect them even more. For example, my sister came to England after the volcano and so on. And normally, whenever I think to go to her house, I always make sure that my clothes is fixed. Yeah. No, it's not a joke. It's serious business. I had to make sure that I look right. If I'm wearing a suit and a tie, my tie have to be straight here. If I make a mistake and put a wrong button my shirt wrong and one button is at the wrong hole, she'll pick it up as soon as I go in and say, come here. And you know, he'll call me and undo it and fix it right. That type of person they were, both of them, they'll do the same thing. So I call them my second mother. Unfortunately, Mrs. Joseph, as we grow, you know, she left and we live far apart, different countries, and I didn't get to see much of her then. But she died last year in Houston, Texas. And I'll say this. Until now, although they're gone, I have a certain kind of respect that I would never forget. And it will live with me as long as I live. They're gone. And we need not worry about them now. The big and important question is, are you ready? Am I ready to meet my Lord when he calls? I believe my sisters were ready. I believe they were ready. And I am preparing myself. I'll be ready to meet them, not in Homerton Hospital, or in Houston, Texas. I'm going to meet my sisters over yonder on the sea of glass. So I can say right now with humble joy, sleep well, sisters. I'll see you in the morning.
To be honest, I have no words that have not already been said. And in some ways, I feel somewhat of a fraud because I didn't spend the quality of time that many others have with Aunt Margaret. But what I can concur with everyone is that she was a heavyweight champion. Diminutive in stature, but a heavyweight champion with encyclopedic knowledge of the scriptures and a very kind heart. I never heard her once say anything amiss about anybody in the entire time that I had with her. She was a very kind-hearted person. She was the golden thread in the tapestry of the family. However, as nice and pleasant as she was, I do actually remember one occasion back in 1980 as a child, a young child, on our one solo family trip to Montserrat, where she administered, let's say, punitive measures to one of her children, who is not even noticing what I'm saying. But she applied, child protection, child services, they didn't know about that. That was back in 1980. But aside from that, on the few occasions, quality occasions we had together, the first or the second words which would come from her lips was, "Hezron, how are the children?" My children, that is. She had a care and concern for the young people. And in many ways, I regard her as the grandmother that I didn't meet. She was the connection to that generation before. And it, as all the pieces emerge of how she was and how things were in those days, I feel very privileged to have had her in the bloodline. She would always ensure that I had an adequate supply of carbohydrates by way of sorrel or morbi or cake, which was more than enough for myself and anybody else. And she could never leave her place without those items. Coming back to her encyclopedic knowledge of scripture, the weight is now on my shoulders to reproduce one of the many poems which she knew by heart. I cannot claim to know it by heart. I will not attempt to recite it by heart. I will read it to the best of my ability. My time is not yet for that. But what we have is a person with a full appreciation of life. Despite the hardships, she was able to see the bright side, a colorful side, and never devoid of a colorful story or tale to amuse us, yet educate us at the same time. And many stories yet are to be unraveled from things that she said and clues that were given into how life was. And so what I will just say to us, especially those of the younger generations, is to lean on the legacy which she has left, and let her testimony not go in vain, and for us to meet her again in the air on that day. Amen.
Thank you very much. May I just kindly ask those who will be coming after. Our program is packed and there's a viewing. So please, when you come, can I kindly ask you to just stick to what you are going to say so that the others who follow can also give their tribute or at least their farewell before the viewing. Thank you very much.
Let me say greetings to the Holy Spirit. Greetings to the household of faith, elders, ministers. Greetings, church. Greetings to the family. I want to say sincere condolences to the Graves family. And what can I say about Didi? Didi was a mother to me. And a very good friend. When I think about Didi, and you know, one of the things that remained with me is the amount of time that Didi said, because in Montserrat they call me Dopey. So it doesn't mean that I'm stupid, it means that I'm short. Anyway, that beside. She would always say, Dopey, boy Dopey, me proud of you. Especially when I got ordained and became a minister. And she would always say, Dopey, me listen to your message, you know? Me tell Algie for put it down, man. I'm listen to it. And, you know, the last time that I visited Didi, Algie, and Yvonne, was there and Didi, and we had a good, you know, we had a good talk. And she again was telling me how much she's proud of me. And I remember that we had a good fellowship that day. We prayed, we sang, and we had me and she and Algie and Yvonne. And I would just describe Didi like the wise man Solomon said. She was a virtuous woman. She loved her children, her grandchildren, all her family for that matter. But I know she loved Dudley, Algie, and Yvonne. And, you know, I want to say that evening or that afternoon when she and Yvonne watched her favorite show and they were talking and she had that episode and she went to the hospital. And Yvonne left her the evening to come back the next morning. But I can imagine that she then had a conversation with Jesus. And he said to her, my daughter, I have kept you for 94 years. I don't want you to suffer. So come home. I can imagine that her mind instantly turned to Algie, Dudley, and Yvonne. How much she's going to miss them. How much she loved them. But you know what? She decided, Savior, I'm coming home. Because heaven was sounding sweeter all the time. Seems like lately she just had it on her mind. So that very night, she just left this world behind. For heaven was sounding sweeter all the time. And I want to say to Dudley, to Yvonne, and to Algie, Shay, the family, the entire family, oh, I know it's so hard to lose a loved one to the grave. But I want to remind you of the blessed hope that Jesus gave. God's gonna wipe all the tears from your eyes when we'll meet him in that land beyond the skies. You know, for heaven was sounding sweeter all the time. Seemed that lately Didi had it on her mind. And that night, she just left this world behind. For heaven was sounding sweeter all the time. Oh, heaven is sounding sweeter all the time. Seems like lately it was always on her mind. And one day we all are gonna leave this world behind, because heaven is sounding sweeter all the time. For heaven is sounding sweeter all the time. Rest in peace, Didi.
Good morning, everybody. I'm Michelle. I bring greetings from Montserrat, and I'm happy to see all of you. It's a sad occasion, but just the fact that we're all here together is a reason to celebrate, and it's a blessing. So I am happy to be here with you this morning. I'm here to read some tributes. My aunt instructed me, so I'm following instructions accordingly. And the first one I'm gonna read is from my brother, Kirtley, who is unable to be with us today. So here beginneth. Writing this last note to you is a lot harder than I could have ever imagined. I've been thinking about what to say, as all of this is still hard to process with you not being here with us right now. I really do miss you. You were always there for me for as long as I can remember. Tyrell and I would always leave our home in Dalston and run straight to your house every other day in excitement that we would get to see our grandma and Auntie Yvonne time and time again. And I remember it not just being the fact that we wanted to get there quickly, but an actual competition to see which one of us would get there first. And of course, I would always lose. However, it wasn't losing the race that made me upset. It was the fact that I wasn't able to be the first one out of Tyrell and myself to greet Granny and Auntie with good morning and good afternoon. You meant everything to me, and your home was also our home. There was not a moment in which I've been to her house that I wasn't looked after, whether it was by giving me a spare jacket, hat, gloves, and even food. Granny and Auntie would always look after Tyrell and I as if we were her own sons. I have also never had a conversation with Granny that didn't involve God, prayer, and reading the Bible. Granny was literally a woman of the Lord and was passionate about her love for God. She prayed for her whole family, not just me. She'd pray for her siblings, all of her children, and her grandchildren in hopes that they would be better and remain healthy and to stay on a path of righteousness. Granny was selfless, full of energy, funny, loving, empathetic, and strong. And I truly believe she left us with no regrets. She had a good life, and I am glad that I could have grown up long enough to be able to realize how amazing she was. Rest in peace, grandmother. We love you. Curtly Graves. This next tribute is from Aki Mead, my Uncle Dudley's son, who is as well unable to be with us here today. Granny was always someone that you knew cared about you and always had you in her heart. Although I was never able to spend much time with her in person, my most prominent memory of her is how she would always be concerned about all of our well-beings. She would always make sure to tell us to keep God in our hearts and mind so that she could know that we would be in a good place. Anytime you talk to her, she would end the conversation with a life lesson for you because she always wanted the best for us, no matter what. Right, this next tribute is from my mom in Montserrat, Cheryl Castle. I met Dee Dee Graves when Mish was just a day old. From that day until today, until the day she died, she always looked out for Mish and myself, especially since Mish was her first grandchild. Yes, I am 32. Dee Dee accepted me without a doubt. She was never afraid to say that I was her daughter-in-law, and I accepted her as my mother-in-law. She would always tell me she loved me. But during the height of the volcanic crisis, when we had to relocate from St. Patrick's to Weeks's, Dee Dee opened her home to not only Mish and myself, but to my mom and my sister as well. I never doubted after that just how much she cared for me. Nothing she had was ever too good to share with me. I really missed them, but thank God for technology and we were still able to communicate with them after they relocated to the UK. Whenever Yvonne or Mish called, Dee Dee would always inquire about everyone else in my family, and she would let us know she was always praying for us. Dee Dee was short, but she was a stalwart. First for God, then her children and grandchildren, and those she deeply cared about. Dee Dee was a strong woman, as we can see for ourselves. She lived to a ripe age of 94 with no ailments except for arthritis. She always encouraged me to trust God and to put Him first in all things, and to keep on praying for her as she does the same for me. The Saturday before she left us, she again reminded me to live for God and to trust Him. She also reminded me how much she loved me. I never thought that would be our last conversation. I will miss our chats and the good laughs we used to have. I sincerely hope that Dee Dee would have made everything right with her Savior. So on that great getting up morning, if we all remain faithful, we shall meet again in that pearly white city. Until then, sleep in peace, Dee Dee. Cheryl Castle. Right, bear with me, two more to go and I'll be done. This one is from Mr. Stephen Francois, close friend of Granny Dee Dee. With the opportunity to migrate to Montserrat in the better times of the 1980s, was just one of the many blessings that were bestowed unto me. Another wonderful blessing was meeting and having to know her, a great lady, stalwart, and mother figure. Deeply religious, but very knowledgeable of the world, it was a pleasure to have conversations with her over the years. There were many admonitions that were sent to me. Stephen, eat healthy and never forget to pray. How are the children? Love and pray for them. And Stephen, you are the better of my sons. Do not follow Alvin. I must confess that these were the times when we, Algy, Bungu, Simeon, King Saul, and myself, ensured as young men that our bodies maintained as much liquid content as possible. Mommy Didi, you are a great inspiration to others and myself as you shared your life stories and experiences so willingly that one may learn and appreciate. I shall miss those London calls, your strong and wonderful voice, your laugh, and most of all, your admonitions. You and your heart of gold are with the Lord. May your beautiful soul rest in peace. Love, your adopted son, Stephen. Right. My tribute, I will not read in the interest of time, but I wanted to highlight just a few things before I go about Granny Didi. Granny Didi is gone, and I'm still trying to accept that. Granny Didi did have a heart of gold, and she loved not only me, but my family. As Mom said, she took us in during the height of the crisis and cared for us all like we were her own kids. Granny Didi was small, but her mouth was big. Granny Didi was feisty, and she was stubborn, and she was very forthright. Sometimes I did not think that the forthrightness was a good thing. Granny Didi was blunt to the point. Sometimes I felt that she was insulting. But now that I am grown, I understand that if we all probably were like Granny Didi, the world would be a better place. We would be more appreciative of each other, and we would be honest, we would be more genuine, and so we would live nicer, happier with each other. 2022 did not start so well for me, but one thing I can say is that Granny Didi taught me that being open and honest is the best way to live. And just, and you know, as some advice for all of us going forward, we should all take a page out of Granny Didi's book, and we should all try to live nicer with each other. We should learn to be forgiving. If you have offended someone, tell them, ask them for pardon. Let them know that you still love them, make amends, because the trajectory that the world is taking, we don't know when our goodbye will be our last goodbye. So I am just saying to all of us today that we really should take some time to reflect and make things right with our friends, our families, and even in ourselves. Thank you.
Thank you so much. It's always very difficult to make an announcement like this, but we're out of time practically. So I'm going to ask whoever else has to come up to please be concise in what you have to deliver, please, just in the interest of time. I see the undertakers already have stood up. Thank you very much.
Margaret Greaves, affectionately known as Didi to her friends, died at the Homerton University Hospital in London on Friday, 17th December, after a very short illness. She was 94 years old. She was born on the 3rd of September, 1927, as a conjoined twin to parents Prince William Graves and Annie Willow on the little pear-shaped island of Montserrat, the Emerald Isle of the Caribbean. They were the first of 10 children. She and her twin sister Agnes, who preceded her in death on 17th March last year in Texas, were born during the hurricane season and would have lost their lives were it not for the mercies of God, as their mom, trying to run from their home to safety with them both tucked tightly in her arms, had to hide under a high foliage of sweetgrass when the winds became too strong for her to continue her flight. Mom and her twin received their early education at the Salem Primary School and later the Seventh-day Adventist Church School, where they were taught by teacher Rupert West. As described by her and in her own words, life was not a bed of roses. Their primary education was frequently interrupted as she and her twin were tasked with caring for the other children who were being born in a rapid succession to each other. Routinely, they also had to accompany their father to the mountains very early in the morning before school to collect milk and food,
not only for their home, but also to sell to the public. After school, their role was to assist in caring for the animals, which were many. She said, however, that amidst all this, she could never forget her mom's positive contribution in their lives, as she taught them how to love God and live for him, the importance of prayer and reading the Bible, and how to love their fellow men. Mom held on to these important principles until the day she died. In 1949, Mom's world was turned upside down when her twin sister Agnes relocated to the island of Antigua to care for her Uncle Joe, who was very ill. She said that she thought she could not survive on her own, for she was so closely bonded to her sister. She eventually relocated to Antigua to be reunited with her. After living and working there for many years, she met our dad, now deceased. She later returned to Montserrat, where we, her children, were born.
Mom spent most of her adult life in Montserrat, where she was born. Mom earned a living primarily by performing domestic work for American and British expatriates on Montserrat. She supplemented her income by farming the land surrounding our family house and two parcels of land in the Center Hills of Salem. My mother was very proficient in plant and animal husbandry. As a young woman, she worked on the waterworks plantation in Montserrat, cultivating cotton, hot peppers, tomatoes, and limes, which the government exported to neighboring islands. Mother received starvation wages for all this strenuous work, which made it very difficult to raise her three children. I remember the times when my mother would wake us up early in the morning and we would walk to Isles Bay Hill, which runs adjacent to the Bellum River Valley, to pick tamarind, shell them, and stuff the fruit into brown bags and sell it to the government. The government used the pulp from the tamarind to make soap and a syrup that was diluted to make a tasty beverage. There was a housing boom in Montserrat, I was told, during the 70s and 80s. The Montserrat Company preferred to use aggregate produced locally for the construction of roads and houses in Old Town Montserrat. My mother was one of those women who participated in this project. When we came home from school, we would go with her to a place called Dr. Woods, situated in the Bellum River Valley, in search of large boulders, which my brother Algie and I would break into smaller pieces using a sledgehammer. My sister and my mother would then reduce these smaller pieces of rock into aggregate size using a smaller hammer. Over time, we would create a mountain of aggregate large enough to make a truckload. The Montserrat Company would send their trucks on Fridays to collect the aggregate and paid each family, I think, about $100 per truckload. I am proud to say that my mother's contribution to real estate development in Old Town was significant. Mom frequently educated us on the best time of the month to plant vegetable seedlings. She told us which phase of the moon was the appropriate time to plant. She reminded us that if you plant crops during a weak moon phase, the harvest would not be bountiful. My mother raised sheep, goats, and chickens and taught her three children how to take care of these animals. My mother ensured that my brother and I bring in our two goats that she named Maggie and Peggy, along with their kids, from the pasture and put them in their pen before 6 p.m. daily. Her love and concern for animals were profound. My mother would insist that we use old bath towels and bed sheets to prepare bedding for the goat and sheep. The task was mandatory, and if we failed to prepare the bedding for the animals, she would wake us up during the night and send us out to do this so that the animals could sleep comfortably. The animals got so accustomed to this that they would not sleep until we made their beds.
If it rained during the night, my mother would ask us to assist her in replacing the damp bedding with dry ones. When it rained heavily during the night, as it often does on Montserrat, my mother would feel sad and worry that the goats and sheep would catch a cold. Mom cared for her animals the same way she cared for her children. She made sure the animals got their medicine when they get sick and would nurse them back to health. It is customary in Montserrat for families to slaughter one or two goats during Christmas. The meat is then used to make goat water, the national dish of Montserrat. My younger brother, Algie, was the butcher. As my brother killed the goat, my mother would start crying. However, she did not abstain from eating the meat which she cooked for dinner. The liver was her favorite part of the goat. She would make a delicious stew from the liver, and we ate this for breakfast on Sundays. My brother made the goat water. My mother loved dogs. We owned two dogs, Bingo and Frisky. Both dogs were Mom's companions when she made her frequent trips to her garden in the Center Hills of Montserrat when we were at school. My mother loved mangoes, and mango season was her favorite season of the year. During the mango season, she would frequently sit on a stool or chair outside the house with a bucket full of mangoes in front of her and eat until she was full. I think that the only other member of our family who loves mangoes like my mother is my cousin Yvette. When my mother finished eating her mango meal, she usually burped, laughed, and said, "Thank you, Jesus." My mother was afraid of cows. One day when she took us with her to her garden in the mountains to help her harvest her agricultural produce, an untethered cow, angry cow, ran out of the bushes and came straight at her. My mother let go of her handbag, held onto her cutlass, and ran away from the cow with the speed of Usain Bolt. We ran along with her until we were out of harm's way before we continued our journey. On the other hand, Mom's reaction to snakes was different. Her vegetable garden in the hills was infested with snakes, and whenever they emerged from their hiding places in the bushes and slithered past her, she would cut their heads off with her cutlass in one swift movement. She would tell us that the snakes reminded her of the devil, Satan. When we were kids, our mom would read and study the Bible with us daily. She took us to church with her on Saturdays and on Sunday and Wednesday night nights for prayer meetings. Her advice to us was put God first in everything. She reminded us frequently that if we honor God, God would honor us. Mother remained faithful to God and to her church until her death. Frequently, during our family worship sessions, Mom would recite poems that she learned in the church as a teenager. Everyone who knows my mother well knows that she loved poems. These poems were very long, and Mom impressed us with her clarity of mind and incredible memory. On one Sabbath morning, the West Indies and England cricket teams were playing a test match. When it was time to go to church, my brother and I pretended that we were coming down with the cold because we wanted to stay home and listen to the test match coverage on our transistor radio. Mother saw through our little scheme and insisted that we get ready for church. Mother was not easily fooled. She was very perceptive. Mother was a woman of fashion. She enjoyed dressing up, something that remained with her until the day she died. She had a hat, a bag, and a pair of shoes to match every dress. Mom was immaculately dressed on every special occasion and loved taking pictures. My mother was one of the most altruistic persons I have ever known. She loved people and people loved her. She was everybody's friend and everybody was her friend. She was a mother to the motherless and a friend to the friendless. My mother's contribution to human growth and social development was significant. When Mom reluctantly relocated to the UK in 1996, her friends say she quickly became one of the most popular persons to walk the streets of Ridley Market. When she made her frequent trips to the market, the young men would volunteer to carry her heavy bags. Then when Mom was finished with her errands, they would help her carry her bags to her flat in Hackney. Monstration young men at the market frequently hid from her if they were smoking weed or cigarette or drinking alcohol and see her coming in their direction. They also apologized when they used inappropriate language in her presence. Kelvin, Tabu, Jubri, and Maccabias were Mom's good friends. They were among the select few to whom she gave her keys of her house to drop off her heavy bags as she continued her shopping at the market. When their mother died in 1958, Mom and her sister had to quit school to take care of their younger siblings. Although she did not receive enough formal education, she understood its value. She made a conscientious effort to educate herself as much as possible by reading everything that was worth reading. She enjoyed reading books and read the Bible and other religious books every day. She memorized parts of the scriptures and encouraged us to do likewise. Mother constantly reminded us that education was important to eliminate the cycle of poverty and to achieve economic independence. My mother was fortunate to live to see all her children and some of her grandchildren graduate from university. I believe in my heart that when Christ returns to reward the faithful, my mother's name will be among those listed on God's honor roll. I will miss her very much.
Mom's health started failing in 2011 when she lost her left eye to cataract and advanced glaucoma. Because she was an avid reader, becoming partially sighted caused her a great deal of emotional trauma. However, because of her strong faith in God and positive attitude, she learned to live with her disability and would spend most of her time witnessing about God's love to and sharing her life's experiences with anyone with whom she came in contact. Her friendly personality and lightheartedness won her many friends and acquaintances. She learned not to take life too seriously, and she enjoyed laughing at herself. One of her greatest desires was that all three of her children would grow up to love and serve God. This she saw as more important than education and fame. As a result of being conjoined, Mom suffered with a sick leg and consequently severe back problems for most of her life. Yet this did not prevent her from enjoying life, which included traveling to several parts of the world. In spite of her constant pain, she was very independent and only asked for assistance if it was extremely necessary. To this end, she was able to attend to her personal care exclusively, even in her twilight years. Mom believed that regardless of one's age, one was supposed to always look good and smell good. She would always be the first one in the bath each morning because she said, "No one knows where sickness is, so just in case, I must look and smell clean." She had no competition when it came to her choice of dress and would frequently dress and undress TV personalities when watching her favorite shows. She could tell whether the tie matched the shirt and would frequently question a lady's choice of colors. In our home, there was no privacy, absolutely none. My mom loved company, she loved life, she loved people, and so she had no problem in people showing up at her door unannounced. Christian or non-Christian, dreadlocks or bald head, she welcomed everyone with open arms and she did anything to make them stay longer than planned. She looked forward to visits, especially from her church family and close friends, several of whom she literally adored. Mom believed in honesty in all things. Consequently, she was very outspoken and she hated pretense. She spoke her mind regardless of who you were and what was the occasion. We became accustomed to this side of her personality, and so we were never offended when she decently told us off if we messed up. On the other side of the coin, though, would be her words of wisdom as she constantly reminded us never to hold a grudge and never to seek revenge. She would always say to me, "Yvonne, you must let things go and allow God to fight your battles." On the evening of December 16, Mom became acutely ill and had to be taken to the hospital. I begged the paramedics to please allow me to accompany her. As ill as she was then, within minutes of being stabilized, she had already made friends with the doctors and nurses in the emergency unit. She assured me that they would do their best to make her as comfortable as possible. I am thankful that I was able to pray with her and hug her that night, for little did I know she would pass quietly in her sleep in the early hours the next morning. There are two things Mom always petitioned God to do for her. Firstly, she could not stand the thought of totally losing her sight. And secondly, she did not want to be bedbound, totally at the mercies of others. God honored both her wishes, and we are thankful. Throughout her entire life, her one desire was to live for God and die peacefully in Him. So take your rest now, Mom. Take your rest. It is our hope that on that great getting up morning, when Christ will return to reward the faithful, and all the dead in Christ shall rise, we will meet Mom again.
Don't worry, I would not be as long as the other two. The stage is a place that I'm very much accustomed, but forgive me, today's a different day, totally different day. Just a couple of things for the next 2 minutes I'd like to bring to you. You know, sometimes you normally say, if you had known so, you would have done something different. I remember on the 10th, vividly, on the 10th of December, I made a trip down to Montserrat. And I remember the morning after taking out my shavers and shaving my mom's head the night. And she held me and she said, you know, your friends down in Montserrat will look after you, like Basil Chambers, who is our adopted son, Stephen Francois. She even said to me that she is sorry that Dr. X, who is here right now, would not be coming to Montserrat with me. She mentioned people like the Conscience, Dunstan Greenaway, Dunstan Lindsay, and also she mentioned a couple of other people. And she said that they will look after me down in Montserrat. And she held me with that firmness, like she didn't want to let me go, knowingly that maybe she knew in hindsight that it was the last time that I was going to be hugging my mom. But hindsight is 20/20. The thing is that, as I said, I would not be long, but you know, my mom is the kind of individual who, you know, I'm married now for well up into the teens, almost 20 years, well up into the teens. And my mom is the kind of individual, so caring, that she will call me about 8 o'clock every morning, religiously call me. And before she come off the phone, she would say to me, "So Algy, did you drink tea? What did you get for breakfast? Did you eat breakfast?" That is the kind of mother that we are laying to rest today. And it pains my heart, telling you. It's not easy to know that we're talking about her now. And the good thing, though, is that she knows that we all loved her. And she knows. We said it to her numerous times. And there's a place for her somewhere up there. My role here now is not to dwell on what's gone, because we're going to meet her again. But I just want to say thank you to not just you for coming here today, but I want to say thanks to a couple of individuals who have made today, you know, what it is. To the professional people who are dealing with Mom today and who have dealt with her since the 17th. The people at the funeral home, the African Caribbean funeral home in Stoke Newington, kudos to you guys. We really do appreciate everything that you have done. You have answered all our calls. You have made exceptional, you know, preparations and accommodation for us to go and see the body view, and so even out of the time. And we really do appreciate. We'll recommend this for anybody. This service is so professional and great, and we want to thank you guys. We also want to say to the pastors, the elders, all the platform personnel, Brother Locker and everybody, all the folks from the Hackney Seventh-day Adventist Church, where my mom fellowshipped, you know, that's where her church is. And, you know, they called, and also for, you know, when they called, the genuine feeling and how they appreciate my mom to make my mom part of the church family. And we want to say thank you guys for that. Also to the officials here at the Holloway Seventh-day Adventist Church, being a larger church, for accommodating us today and allowing everyone to see this on the live stream, all the folks from the AV unit, we want to say thank you very much for doing so. And the lovely flowers that's on display from a company called Mead's Florists up in Clapton, we want to say thank you guys as well for being so professional and supportive at this very, very distressing time. For the musicians, you hear the lovely music, Allo and Thelma, we want to say thank you guys for coming out and doing what you do and for helping us. For people like Calvin and my cousin Denzel, for all what you guys have done, we want to say thank you very much. For all the choristers. And also, quickly, I just want to say thank you to all the many folks who have called us as a family. As I said this morning, I was following the hearse coming down, and Basil Chambers, before he did his program this morning, he called and he said, look, my brother, I am with you. You know, to every, there's so many people that we cannot mention everyone, but I just want to let you know that your calls have been appreciated. And for everyone who is supporting us today, X and Ivan and all you folks, Swazi and all you guys who have come down from Birmingham, Gene and the whole family, look, thank you guys. And everybody here today, just want to say thank you for coming out, and let us put this wonderful lady to rest. Thank you very much.
We want to say thank you to the family, and especially the last remarks that we heard. Remarks of appreciation for your love, for your care, for your dedication and your devotion. I just want to let you know that because of time, the family have asked that we will not have the viewing. And I want to thank the funeral directors for their patience. I want to echo the sentiments that have been shared this afternoon. Mom seems to be an extraordinary person, and the encounter that she has made with each one of us here seems to be one of memorable occasion that we hope will lead beyond this meeting today. Mom loved people, and that is for sure. At church, some of the people that Mom actually remembered happened to be Sister Merchant, and she also was very fond of Sister Hermina. People that Mom cared about, that Mom valued and adored. I've heard from the eulogy and from the many tributes that have been brought, the phrase, I will see you again. Where does that phrase come from? Where do you intend to see Mom? At Asda? Tesco? At Montserrat? Where do you plan to see her if you have the desire that you are going to see Mom again? May I just quickly just lead you to the book of John. It's chapter 11, and the disciples find themselves with Jesus, and here is Jesus saying, our friend Lazarus is sleeping. Now, many of you went to bed last night, so you can identify with that. Our friend Lazarus is asleep, but guess what? Let us go and wake him up. They haven't had any appointment with Lazarus. There isn't any discussion with Lazarus. And the question is, why go and wake Lazarus up if he's sleeping? The obvious question that disciples asked was, Jesus, okay, take it easy. If Lazarus is asleep, then Lazarus is going to wake up. Why do you have to go and wake him up? The text follows. The Bible says, in verse 14, then said Jesus unto them plainly, Lazarus is dead. This is very, very important, because the Bible tells us in the book of Isaiah 55, verse 8, the Bible says of God, your thoughts are not my thoughts, neither are your ways my ways. This is one of the areas where God's ways are never our ways, and his thought never our thought. For us, the late Mrs. Margaret Elizabeth Grieve is dead. That is for you. But for God, she's asleep. This is where the transition comes. Jesus has promised us that one day, one of these days, he is going to come and end all the misery of this world. And at that coming, the Bible tells us in the book of Thessalonians that the Lord himself will descend and call forth all those who have taken a vow to put their trust in him. In fact, Jesus himself says, I have the keys of death. Jesus can open and he can lock. And so today, we are watching a service where our beloved mom is just sleeping, awaiting the day when Jesus in his goodness and his love will come and give her the gift of eternal life. One day, this promise will become a reality. In John 14, 1 to 3, the Bible says, let not your hearts be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you, I am going to prepare a place for you. And once I'm done, I will come back and receive you unto myself, that where I am, there you may be also. The gift that God gave the late Mrs. Margaret Grieve, God gives you the same gift today. It's a gift of choice, an opportunity to choose to be reunited with her on the great getting up morning. Jesus makes this a possibility when he says, I am standing at the heart, the door of your heart, and I'm knocking. My question is, where is Jesus? Frankie, where is Jesus? Dudley, where is Jesus? Yvonne, where is Jesus? Is he in or is he out? I pray that today you hear the knock and open the door and let him in. God bless you. Amen. We now have our prayer of consolation and then a song.
Just going to invite everyone to stand for the benediction. We'll just have the closing prayer. We can have the closing song as we exit the building. Let's pray. Gracious Father in heaven, we just want to thank you for the life of Sister Margaret Grieve, a life that was well lived, a life that lived knowing you, and she died in you. And for that, we are so thankful. And Father, now we just want to ask you that she will rest in peace until you come in glory. And we just want to put the family before you and ask you that you will comfort and you will heal their broken heart. We pray, O Lord, that we will be with them in them long days when they miss her, in them lonely nights when they crave to hear her voice. We ask that your Holy Spirit and your presence will be with them just to comfort them in this time. And now, Father, as we take her to a final place of rest on this earth, we pray that your continued presence and your spirit will guide us and be with us. Keep us safe and well, and we ask you that you will keep us close to the cross of Jesus, so that when you come on that resurrection morning, when Sister Margaret Greaves rises up, we will be able to see her again and meet her again and spend Sister Sages with you. These things we pray in the name of Jesus Christ, our Savior. Amen. Amen.
Angels' voices.
Angel voices sweetly singing, echo through the blue dome ringing, news of wondrous gladness bringing, artist heaven at last. Heaven at last, heaven at last, oh the joyful story of heaven at last. Heaven at last, heaven at last, endless, boundless glory in heaven at last. On the jasper threshold standing, like a pilgrim safely landing, see the strange by streams expanding, artist heaven at last. Heaven at last, heaven at last, oh the joyful story of heaven at last. Heaven at last, heaven at last, endless boundless glory in heaven at last.
Last one.
Christ himself, the living splendor, Christ, the sunlight mild and tender, praise to the Lamb re-render, for art is heaven at last. Heaven at last, oh, the joyful story of heaven at last. Heaven at last, heaven at last, endless, boundless glory in heaven at last.